time.
I know.
We're depending on each other.
Oh, vocal cords.
Yeah.
You're screaming at people and you don't even know them.
The first floor was loud. The second floor, quieter.
I think this fellow,
we lost you.
We went up.
Hi. I can do it like this.
You can do it like
Hi, everybody.
You can lapel it or...
Hi. Listen, I'm Al Pacino and I'm wearing sunglasses. It's a disguise. So just so you know. However, I do have an allergy. And because I have an allergy, I'll be wearing these sunglasses.
Lovely sunglasses.
You know, otherwise I just have to do this.
You just want people to know that you're not being...
I'm not being...
eccentric.
Exclusive or something.
Yeah.
So Greta's my favorite interview, actually. She interviewed my three-year-old. Last year, he was 3 years old, I guess.
Yeah.
And she did a really great job.
You know, I met you one time, maybe 2 years ago. You were much smaller. I remember it. You don't remember it, but it's okay. It was just a one day in your life.
I'm still three, but on my birthday, I'm going to be 4.
When's your birthday?
A week ago.
January?
January 3rd.
That bad. It was a week ago.
So the world turns a new age, and then you turn a new age.
Yeah.
Because it changes the year. Everyone has a birthday than you do. It's really nice. It's like a built-in celebration.
She can do it. The basic idea is to chat, so it's free conversational. The idea is not to do junket questions and answers.
Is that the idea?
You feel free to curse or anything else you want. Or stand up if the urge takes you. Welcome to go wherever you want.
This is unusual.
I know, it's a free-for-all.
Is this a film?
It's video, yes.
Okay.
So.
I'm ready. Should I explain that? The reason I'm wearing sunglasses?
Oh, I think we may have the sunglasses.
We have
I think you should just do it again. No.
I have an allergy, and I could do this all night. I could tell everybody I have an allergy, because it's just fun to talk like that.
You know, there's a Japanese actor who has a drippy eye.
Really?
Who always has a piece of napkin with him and is always like wiping his eye in every conversation you ever have with him.
Really?
Yeah. It's Takashi, I'm forgetting his last name, but he's like one of the big Japanese directors and actors.
Mm.
Older guy, great actor, but anyway.
So it doesn't bother me at all.
Oh, thanks.
So you said last night on stage that this was personal to you, or you wanted to finding personal things was important to you. So when this came to you, was it already where it ended up in terms of your personal take on it?
Well, I read the book by Phillip Roth and thought this would be interesting because I relate to that. It's a world I know pretty well, being an actor my whole life. And this is about an actor. And there are a lot of movies been made about actors, actresses. And so I thought, let's see, there's something interesting about, of course, Phillip Roth, you know, insightful and great. He's one of the greatest writers. And I thought, how do we make this a movie? So I contacted Barry Levinson, who's a friend and I know. And I said, what do you think of this? And he felt very similar. And we both got together and started to think about who should we get to write it. John Burnham, my agent, suggested Buck Henry. And he got together with us. He seemed really right for it. Because we saw this as a tragic comedy. Have you seen the film?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's what we set out to touch it. Because it was very funny to us. I don't know that the Philip Roth novel was meant to be funny. But we adapted it into that. And I think, because Philip Roth cannot help but being funny. I mean, he writes things sometimes that are in such irony. And anyway, that's what we worked. And then surprisingly, the script, I thought, you know, because both Barry and Buck make movies. And so they opened it up in a way that writing screenplays are, you know, just different than writing, you know, plays or books, prose. And so they have the appropriate craft to make a movie out of it, and they did.
Are you very hands-on in having the conversations as you're going along, or
well, in this particular movie, I was sort of hands-on with it because you know I got the book and usually I let we all try to let I guess that's what you learn after a while. Let people who do their thing, you know, and invariably. And that includes makeup and costumes. And sometimes we get a little bit overzealous in telling everybody their job. And I've just stayed away from that, and it works, because these people can do it. I mean, it's what they do, and they do it a lot better than I do, and especially the screenwriting. I don't think I could write a line in a movie. I could say it, maybe, if I'm in the middle of an improvisation, but to think about writing. See, Greta's a writer, so, you know, I go to her for all my...
writing tips. So how did you, what was the phone call like to get you into the middle of all this?
Well, I was in one of my periods of unemployment, and I was sitting at home crawling the walls and going crazy and feeling like nothing good would ever happen again. And then they said, and then I got this email that was like this, an adaptation of a Phillip Roth book by Buck Henry, and Barry Levinson's directing, and Al Pacino's in it, and Diane Weist and Kira Sedgwick. I thought I had hallucinated it. I was like, is this real? Is this really happening? Really? And then they were like, yes, Barry would like to have you read. And I went and I read, and but it was so fast. I got the part, and then like, 3 or 4 days later, I was like yelling at Al, which was, it was just like, no time to be nervous, just go ahead and do this. So it was a quick turnaround, but I went from very sad to very happy in a short amount of time.
So you didn't really get a chance to get too nervous?
No, I mean, I was nervous, but I also, I kind of made a series of very brash decisions about it, and I decided I would try to channel some Pagin into my, I was like, I got the part, and then I was like, oh, you've got a phone call.
I'm so sorry. I'm here to bail you out.
No.
Oh, no.
You also have a, this
is my son. I'll talk to him later. He so rarely calls me. I'll call him later. He'll be all right. Sorry.
Are you sure?
I should have kept it up.
Oh, did that fall out of your pocket?
Oh, I'm a little late to be giving me your card. We just made a movie together.
I don't know if you'd be interested.
Oh, no, it's somebody.
But yeah, anyway, I did all these very fast decisions, and I went for it. I feel like I showed up on set, and Barry didn't recognize me. Oh, did it fall out?
Really? Did I do something wrong? Oh, yes.
You gotta put your mic back on.
It just doesn't want to stay on me.
Ugh.
It's, I understand. Wrong. They don't want it. They don't want to hear the stuff I got to say.
No.
I'm learning how to do this. Oh, how ridiculous. Okay.
I'll do it.
Okay.
Got it.
So you've had kind of a long run before this of, you were doing a lot of theater. And you had the...
Well, I sort of done theater my whole life, you know, I mean, a lot of theater.
But it seemed like you prioritized theater for a period over making a lot of movies.
Oh, yeah, well, I've always tried to do both, but it's just what's available. I think I did a couple of three HBO things, from Angels in America. So those took up a lot of time. I got young children, which was a part of my life. I did a couple of movies and a couple of plays.
Went on forever with you.
Well, Salome will go on forever.
It's an ongoing.
It's an experience that you know, and it's still going. I'm doing it in Omniverse in London. We're having Jessica Chastain. She plays Salome. She's absolutely great, stunning, in it. And so that's reason enough to keep going with it. And I directed it. It's a documentary, and it's a sort of stage reading of the play before the documentary. Then the documentary goes on, and you say, it's an intermission, and then the documentary goes on about it, about Oscar Wilde, about us trying to put it on in L.A., and it's interesting, it's different.
So, I mean, are you
Omniverse means you do it in 100 theaters or so at the same time, simultaneously, right. And then it's over. Right. And there's an interview with Jessica, myself, Stephen Fry, and Oscar Wilde's grandson in London.
So Jessica gives you a lot of credit for her coming of age as an actress, as it were. I mean, do you see yourself as a mentor? Do you see yourself as...
No.
No.
Absolutely not. No, this woman is a prodigy. You know, as soon as she came in and read for me, I just turned to the producer, Robert Fox. Am I dreaming? Or are you dreaming? He said, no, this is happening. This is how deep she got into this character. And it was just... So I said, well, we'll make a movie of it then, because with her, it's... And then she went on to do all these other things. People saw her, some people saw her in the Salome movie and wanted to work with her.
So you didn't mentor Greta, as it were. So
Greta's the same thing. Greta came in. Barry sent me, I don't know if I ever told you, he sent me a videotape of you. I thought, oh my, done it again. I'm going to get credit for her. How about that? She's amazing, you know, just amazing. And
thank you.
So I have to say.
So the movie has a lot of you kind of carrying the weight of being a celebrity actor, as it were. How close to home does that hit? Are you very conscious of being Al Pacino, or is that just...
Well, now that you mention it, I'm sort of conscious of it, you know. You are after a while. You'd be damn fool if you weren't aware of it. You know, you're dealing with it, facing it every day. So, you know, as the great Lee Strasberg once said to me when I was going through a tough time with it all, he said, darling, you simply have to adjust. So you adjust to it, you know, and so that's what you do. And that's what I guess I've been doing. And the character, to me, had a real, it's good to make a movie or anything when you have some sense of the world you're in. Some, like doing a movie in your own wheelhouse, we like to say. So it helps to, you know, just get together with people who feel that way and know the world you're in. You're making a movie about the theater, you're making a movie about something you know. So you have a little bit more confidence or credibility because you feel you know it. Whereas in other movies, you know, you're playing whatever you're playing, you know, whether it's a cop or someone who's, I've got a David Gordon Green film here also called Megalhorn, a whole world I didn't know. That's challenging in another way. This was a world we were familiar with, so there was a bit of shorting in it. We did it in 20 days, so that's... And we did it in increments. And I seem to be talking a lot here.
Okay. It's good.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Greta's a good listener.
She's great. But, you know, we did it in increments. So that means we did it 5 or 6 days and went away and it came back 5 or 6 more days. Barry then put the footage together, cut it while we were off doing other things, came back. So it came to about 20 days of shooting. No reshoots or anything, just did it. He really knows what he's doing, though. Barry Levinson is a great director, and you're going to do this, you're going to be with someone like that to do it, because that makes it possible.
So is your comfort zone Francis Ha?
Comfort zone?
Is that the place where you feel like you're in your universe that you've created in some situation like that, or is it different than this?
That feels like a different kind of galaxy. I mean, I think this movie was like incredibly, like we had this great script that we used, but then it was a ton of improv, and it was like a lot of throwing things out there. It was a lot of fast adjustments and decisions. And I mean, for me anyway, like because I always think of like the way something was made, and Francis was so, there was not a word that was different from the script. Everything was placed just so. It was very particularly blocked and shot. And this was much more, we had two cameras going the whole time. So in some ways it was more, it just taps into a different part of yourself. So I guess, I mean, I don't know, as an actor, it's just a different thing to kind of have the access to the person in you that just can come up with lines again and again and just keep yelling at you.
She did.
I know. I'm sorry.
She yelled at me throughout the movie as a character.
As a character.
So did you enjoy this? I mean, was it fun? Do you enjoy improv? And
oh yeah. Well, you know, in a lot of ways, it was like we were thrown in the pool. We were surviving through it, but we enjoyed doing that. And she does it magnificently. She just is so open to it. And she has a real sense of the character she's playing. So, you know, improvisation is improvisation. Sometimes you improvise a lot in order to learn about your characters and stuff. Right. It isn't the end all. It winds up on the cutting room floor. But here we improvised as it being what we knew right there. It was really happening. So what you see in this is pretty much us, you know, living through it, which is it. But there's a script. We go by the script.
Yeah.
We have words though. But there were times that Barry is very open to that. And when you have a director you can trust like Barry, you sort of go and do things you wouldn't normally do.
Right.
Because you know he's got the intelligence and the sensitivity to turn it into something.
Well, did you have a sense of what it would look like? Because one of the things that's striking about the movie, for a small movie, is how much kind of voiceover work and interwoven with other stuff. It's beautifully cut together.
What an interesting way, and it was all his idea of getting the therapist on the videotape and a way of blending the voiceover. So kind of.
No, I didn't have any sense of how it would look.
I just know this is down again.
It's down. Here, I'll do it. Don't worry. This is going to be my new job. You mentored me into my mic work.
Well, no, it's funny because like my experience of Mr. Pacino is a lot, part of it is I think there was a period you were in California and you used to hang out at this coffee place in Santa Monica, and there were always like, you know, 10 people around you kind of like, you know, touching the hem of your garment or whatever people do. I mean, there was this kind of like this.
You were read into it, don't you?
I did. Well,
that wasn't what was happening though, I think. Probably I was being lectured by someone.
Does that happen often?
And sometimes it was me that was doing the lecturing, and sometimes it was someone else. Well, you know, it was great because it was where my dear friend Charlie lived. People used to see me all around. I'd be there with a wheelchair because Charlie had MS and was in a wheelchair. So I was out there a lot seeing him, visiting friends in Santa Monica, for example. And we'd go to these various cafes that were out in the open, which is great to do in LA because of the weather.
Yeah. You know. So has it changed for you in all these years of being Al Pacino? Or being, does acting change? Does the work itself change very much?
It doesn't seem to change. I mean, you're still left with that thing. Who are you? Who's the character? Where are you going? What are you doing? Why are you doing it? You know, these essentials. And what's wonderful is that there's still roles that you can connect to. And I think that's... See, we live in a world where it's the play is the thing, you know, and the text is the thing, and it's the one that informs you as to why we do this. And if you find something that you connect to, that's basically... See, often happens... In my younger time, is you find yourself doing roles that you don't necessarily connect to, but because of your fame and opportunities to work with people, you get involved sometimes with things, and you don't have the same alacrity, you know, or appetite. The way now this guy in The Humbling is suffering from a lack of appetite or desire to do that very difficult thing, which is stage acting and great Shakespearean roles, etc. And unless you have an appetite or a desire, you're stuck because it's a hard job to do without it. You know, you do it a certain amount of technical stuff. And I think he sees in his physical sense of things, both mental and physical, is starting to leave him. He doesn't have the same equipment. In an athlete, it's more definable. You can see it, you know, you just... I remember myself, I used to be somewhat of an athlete growing up. I enjoyed playing sports, all kinds of sports. And I remember one time playing softball in the park, and I hit the ball, and I started running down first base, and I just was doing everything I've always done, except the trees weren't going by as fast. I was just running, and I knew, oh man, I better not just stop because I'll fall. And I knew it was over, a certain thing was over. So it was obvious I wasn't getting down to first base fast enough. And then with acting, it's pretty much like, oh man, can we make it 6 performances a week instead of 8? Or I don't know if I can be ready to learn those words in this amount of time, or you're in the middle of a scene and you're all of a sudden in another scene. You don't know how you got there. Mm. And then you want to talk about terror, you know. That's terror.
So the words for your character are not... you've experienced some of that.
Well, I've experienced some of it. So that's where the understanding of who my character was. But I think with a series of these things, and not having a support system in him somehow, he didn't have anything. And he would go home alone, so he had that drink after the show, which we were talking about. Laurence Olivier said, what does he like most about acting? And it was the drink after the show. So he didn't have that. And with the lack of memory and stuff, you know, he started to think it was harder to do. Therefore, he lost a little of his appetite and then his desire. And this goes on for a year or so. Pretty soon, you're starting to top yourself.
So do you identify with this yet? Greta?
With this character?
Yeah, the loss of for an actor.
Oh,
not quite yet.
No. No, I still have like
a lot of fun.
I still have utter cockiness in terms of like I know it'll go away. Like I still a little bit have the thing of one, you just know your line. You just know them.
You know your words.
You know your words almost, you have, but the, everybody says, oh, honey, after you have kids, you can't remember anything. Like, everybody in their 20s and 30s, like, you can, your brain is able to just grab onto text, especially when you're doing it a lot and you're memorizing large chunks of text. You find yourself, I don't know if when you've been in play, like, you're able, it doesn't diminish your capacity, it increases your capacity. Yeah. It's not like you have a certain amount of bandwidth that will take text, and once it's used up, it's used up. It's that you have a capacity, and the capacity gets strengthened.
Yeah.
So when you're doing it all the time, and then all of a sudden you can really, I mean, people, what I always say to myself is people can memorize the Quran, we can memorize, yeah. You know, yeah. You can do it. It's just, you have to be...
There's a freedom in it, too.
Yeah, once you know it, and then it... Don't you find with Shakespeare, though, once you know Shakespeare, you have it forever?
That's right.
You never lose it. It's in you.
It's in you.
For the rest of your life.
That's what came out in the movie. If you noticed, there's a couple of quotes I do from Shakespeare reviews. You just do it.
Right.
It's in me. It's when I say, perdition catch my soul, but I do love thee. When I love thee, not chaos is coming in. That's just in my head.
I know. Yeah. Because I think it's the way it's written and the preciseness of the words.
Exactly.
You don't ever lose it. It's just something you have, like an appendage.
That's
your
right.
Shakespeare appendage.
I was working with an actor, a wonderful actor, very experienced in Shakespeare also. And from time to time, I have to make this confession. I'll change a word in Shakespeare, but it has to be in the iambic. But because the word is not clear, and sometimes, like, I keep thinking, you know, that's what, if William was alive, I would say, hey, Willie, give me something here, will you? Because I don't think they're getting that, because it's a different language. And I do it occasionally. And I don't tell anybody that, because it's all right, you know. But you know, we know that when Shakespeare's writing these plays, an actor is saying to him, hey, Bill, I got to go over here. I got to be. He says, yeah, well, not to be. Then. I said, well, to be or not to be? And then he says, well, what's that? That's the question. So I'll get you something later. Because he worked with the actors. He was an actor,
yeah.
I believe. I can feel it. And so when you're learning the words, you're apt to forget them. The beautiful thing is learning it, to forget it. It's like a ballet dancer,
yeah.
Right? They go through all these exercises so that when they do those pliés on stage or jetés, they're not worried about it because they've done it. And that's with us too. We learn the words so much.
You can forget about it.
Right. You can improvise with them too.
Right.
Which, you know, I mean, I started to do that with
only Gary. You can improvise Shakespeare in iambic pentameter.
No, I couldn't. No,
that most people.
I know. She reminded me. I have to tell you this story. Tears and all. Here's the reason. This is so interesting, what she's just said. This is so much fun to talk to her. I mean, she's so, this guy comes up to me knowing that I did that a little bit. I won't mention his name, but yes, a swell guy and a great actor and did many Shakespeare's. He says, Al, tonight I'm going to change this line. I just want you to know it. It was more. He says, what do you think of this? And he says the line. I said, yes, it's clearer. It is clearer. I said, but you should practice it, you know, because this is an experienced Shakespearean actor, because there we are on stage, and it comes that moment, and I'm waiting for it, because I know what's going to happen, where his eyes start crossing, and I know he's trying to find the line, put it in the thing, and he does it somehow. And I knew, and afterward, I said to him, you know, you're going to probably have to do it 6 or 7 more times. You're going to go through that before it fits, because it's a beautiful thing once you learn it, like you said before. Yeah. It sort of comes to you because it's trippingly on the tongue, as Shakespeare says.
All right.
Excellent.
Oh, are we? Oh, bye.
We're done.
We are done.
Just getting started.